Yeah, so I guess you just heard a lot about post-translational modifications, and now I'll actually try to show you some applications of where we use, in this case, phosphoproteomics to study cancer drug resistance and leukemia, and also use it to study spatiotemporal phosphosignaling dynamics. So I basically divided my talk into these two parts. So initially, I will start with the application where we used quantitative proteomics and phosphoproteomics to study cancer drug resistance and leukemia. And then I will move on to show you one of our most recent studies, ongoing project, where we use spatial temporal phosphosignaling dynamics. Initially with the proof of concept in the EGF signaling network, and then with an application in osmotic shock response. And I will also give you some conclusions on perspectives along the way. So cancer drug resistance can basically occur in many different ways. So you can either have cancer cells that are intrinsically resistant to the drug, and that could be due to, for example, resistance causing mutations. But you can also have cells that basically acquire drug resistance as part of the treatment. And this can happen in different ways. So it can either be through specific selection of resistance causing mutations. It can be through so-called evolution, where the cells basically become drug tolerant, so-called persister cells. And then these cells can again acquire resistance-causing mutations, or they can actually require other resistance-causing mutations. And we basically had the working hypothesis that although these are quite different mechanisms that are causing resistance, could it be that it's actually the same protein signature that is involved in these different types of resistance? And to study this in more depth, we turned to T-cell acute lymphoblastic leukemia pathogenesis, where it's known that T-cell differentiation involves the NOTCH receptors, and in particularly the NOTCH1 receptor at every different stage during development. And that basically mutations in this receptor often leads to T-cell malignancies such as this T-cell acute lymphoblastic leukemia. And it's already been shown in large-scale studies that mutations in the NOTCH receptors, and in particularly NOTCH1, basically occurs in roughly 75% of all patients that have T-ALL. And the NOTCH signaling pathway is normally regulated and really important for differentiation, maintenance of stem cells, etc. And it's activated by ligands that are on opposing cells that binds to the receptors that then leads to activation and cleavage by the gamma secretase protease that then release this intracellular domain that goes from the plasma membrane and into the nucleus where it can act as a transcriptional activator. But during tumorigenesis, when the receptor acquires activating mutations, it basically leads to activation without the ligand present and the cleavage of the intracellular domain, and then uncontrolled proliferation and migration of the cells and ultimately drug resistance. And to treat these mutated receptors, there's been a lot of attention towards these so-called gamma secretase inhibitors, but unfortunately, they are usually highly toxic, and also the patients develop resistance during prolonged treatment. So we decided to use two different model systems, one involving intrinsic resistance to these GSIs, and one that is based on acquired resistance. So initially, we basically chose a T or ALL cell line panel consisting of three sensitive cell lines and three resistant cell lines. And then we also took one of the sensitive cell lines and turned it into a resistant cell line by basically long-term treatment in the presence of the GSI. And initially, we just basically showed that there's quite a significant difference, more than 100-fold up to 1,000-fold difference in the IC50 values for the GSI between the sensitive cells and the resistant cells. And that is even though that both of the cells type actually respond very nicely to the GSI treatment in such a way that you can prevent the cleavage of the NOTCH1 both in the sensitive and in the resistant cell types. So this is not due to inhibition or mutations in the gamma secretase protease. So we basically perform quantitative mass spectrometry-based proteomics using a standard workflow. In this case, we used TMT labeling and high pH reverse phase fractionation before analyzing all the peptides in the mass spectrometer. And we used the Q-exactive mass spectrometer, and we analyzed both the proteome expression changes and also the phosphorylation site changes by also performing a titanium dioxide enrichment. And we quantified roughly 10,000 proteins and around 30,000 phosphorylation sites. And when we then compared in a global hierarchical clustering, the resistant versus sensitive cell lines, we could see that, interestingly, they basically are very different already at the basal proteome level. So just by an unbiased hierarchical clustering, we could basically separate the resistant from the sensitive cells. And we could see that the proteins that are upregulated in the sensitive cells are proteins that are involved in DNA transcription, whereas those that are upregulated in the resistant cells are more proteins that are involved in small molecule metabolic processes and cellular lipid metabolic processes. We then took advantage of this basically connectivity map to also map all our proteomics data and compare it to all the different treatments that have been performed systematically in this large-scale study here, and we could see that our data basically correlated very well with mTOR inhibitors and protein synthesis inhibitors. And when we looked at our phosphoproteome, we could see that in the resistant cells, we had a quite significant upregulation of phosphorylation sites on the ribosomal protein S6, which is known to basically signal protein translation in the cells. And we can also validate this by Western blotting. We can see that the three resistant cell types, they have very high elevated levels of phosphorylated ribosomal protein 6. We then turned to the acquired resistant cells that we generated by increasing the amounts of GSI in the media over time, and we grew them for up to 12 weeks, after which we could demonstrate that the cells had basically increased their resistance towards GSI by more than 100-fold. And again, performing an unbiased quantitative proteomics experiment, we could see that the proteins that are upregulated in the persister cells basically all are on the same pathways that were associated with the intrinsically resistant cells, so they again the small molecule metabolic processes. Looking at the kinase signatures of GSI resistance, we overlaid the phosphorylation sites that were upregulated in the persister cells with those that were upregulated in the resistant cells versus the sensitive cells, and we saw again that the ribosomal S6 protein had highly elevated phosphorylation sites, and that this basically coincided with increased phosphorylation of protein kinase C delta. And this was validated initially in the resistant cells, where we could see that they indeed have elevated levels of phosphorylated protein kinase C delta, and that this was also the case in the persister cells compared to the parental cells, and that actually in an unbiased analysis of all the CCLE TAL cell lines, we could see that those cell lines that are known to be resistant to GSI generally have elevated levels of protein kinase C delta compared to the sensitive cells. And luckily, there is a very good inhibitor for protein kinase C delta called sortilstaurin that we took advantage of, where we could, by treating the persister cells, could show that with that increasing dose that we're able to basically reduce the level of phosphorylation on ribosomal protein S6. And then performing a long-term treatment with this inhibitor, sortilstaurin, we could show that over time we are basically able to completely kill the persister cells, but only in the presence of sortilstaurin, which is basically after 5 weeks of treatment, we can see that we have completely removed the phosphorylation of ribosomal protein S6.
Hey, we also, Jesper, we have a couple questions that came in. Yes. I could throw up if you got a second. How much starting material did you need to detect the 30,000 phosphopeptides and 10K proteins?
Yeah, so I mean, the advantage we have for TMT labeling is, of course, that we can start with relatively low amount, so a few hundred micrograms per condition, and then because we pool the different TMT reporter samples together, we actually end up with a few milligrams that we can then perform high pH reverse phase fractionation on, and then analyze the individual fractions to basically boost the levels of phosphorylation. So yeah, so altogether we typically have a few milligrams, but for each individual cell line and replicate, we have around a couple of hundred micrograms of peptides.
Okay, very good. And then are most of those 30K quantified?
Yeah, the majority is quantified. I should of course mention that we do not do MS3 level quantification. We only do MS2 level quantification of the TMT reporter ions. So we obviously have some ratio compression, but we still see that we have very good reproducibility of the ratios and the directionality, of course, of the regulation is still intact.
And then one more question on this segment. It says, according to the schema, you're adding non-phosphopeptides back into the enriched ones. Is that accurate?
No, I think that that was
you
not.
You do not mix them.
Yeah. No. Okay. So usually we just take out a small fraction of the labeled cells and use that for the proteome analysis.
Got it. Okay, thank you for clarifying.
Yeah. Yeah, and we then also basically wanted to validate in a more in vivo relevant model if we could reproduce the data that we have seen in cell lines. So we used a PDX model that is resistant to anti-NOTCH1 inhibitors, and analyzing these cells compared to a treatment with a control antibody, we could again see that the inhibition of NOTCH receptors leads to upregulation of phosphorylation sites of protein kinase C delta. So we performed in vivo combination treatment in this model, targeting both the NOTCH receptors using a GSI compound and then the PKC delta inhibitor using sortilstaurin. And we can see that it's only the combination treatment that really reduced the number of leukemic cells in the peripheral blood. And that is actually even better visualized by looking at the amount of leukemic burden in the spleen, where we can see that the combination treatment, especially in one case, we can really significantly decrease the number of leukemic cells compared to the control situation or any of the two treatments by themselves. So we basically think that we have found a new nice way to do combination inhibition in order to overcome resistance to NOTCH inhibition. So in the normal acute treatment condition, when we inhibit NOTCH, we basically downregulate c-MYC and thereby phosphorylation of the S6 ribosomal subunit that then basically prevents cell survival. But during chronic treatment with the inhibitor, we upregulate protein kinase C delta that thereby can reactivate the phosphorylation of ribosomal kinase S6 and lead to activation of c-MYC downstream and thereby cell survival. Conversely, if we were to inhibit the cells with sortilostarin, then we actually relieve the NOTCH1 inhibition that again leads to MYC activation and cell survival. So it's only when we combine the two inhibitors that we can induce apoptosis very effectively in the T-ALL cells. So the main take-home messages from this study that we just published a couple of months ago in Nature Communications is that we can use proteomics to study cancer biology and drug resistance in an unbiased way, that GSI-resistant cells rely on the same cellular pathways despite the origin of the GSI resistance, so both genetic mutations or epigenetic reprogramming. There seems to be a connection between GSI resistance and upregulated PKC delta signaling, and that this combination treatment of GSI with protein kinase C delta inhibition using sortilostarin enhances the anti-leukemic activity of GSI in PDX models and completely abrogates the development of acquired GSI resistance in vitro. So from this type of more clinically oriented study, I will now shift gears a bit and focus on a recent development in the lab where we wanted to study the spatial temporal cellular signaling dynamics. And of course, it's very well known that signaling, for example, initiated by growth factors such as EGF, leads to activation of receptors at the plasma membrane that would then signal intracellularly through different kinase cascades that ultimately leads to phosphorylation of different transcription factors in the nucleus that can then exert their functions by expressing different reprogramming programs that can lead to either cell differentiation, cell proliferation, or apoptosis. But usually in proteomics, we just study all of these events directly in a total cell lysate, so we kind of miss out on the subcellular dimension of the signaling cascades. So in order to actually look at spatial regulation of the proteome, this has mainly been done by microscopy using antibody stainings. For example, there are a lot of beautiful images in the protein atlas where one can really see that some proteins have very unique subcellular locations, whereas others have distributed locations in different compartments in the cell. And there has actually been a number of very elegant proteomic studies where they have shown that it's actually possible to map the subcellular proteome with very high depth sensitivity and resolution. So both from the lab of Catherine Lilly and from the lab of Yanni Letier. But in all cases, there's been some limitations to this, that this has only been performed at the level of the protein level, and they have disregarded the phosphoproteome layer. And both of these methods actually require very extensive acquisition time and experimental workflows that are not really useful and geared for high throughput applications. So we basically teamed up with Fridtjof Lund Johansen's group from Oslo University, who had developed a very elegant and simple fractionation scheme that is based on different biochemical buffers, where we can, using different detergents and salts, can basically get out six different fractions that we can then use for proteomic analysis. And what we did was to take 5% of the individual fractions and then analyze them using our FAMES strategy on the Explorers 480 mass spectrometer. And the remaining 95% we then used for titanium IMAC enrichment and performed direct DIA analysis on these fractions. And basically, our workflow then allow us to do very fast profiling, and with just 4 hours of analysis per condition, we can basically cover 6 fractions on phosphorylation level and 6 fractions on the protein level. And we can see that this methodology is actually highly reproducible. So we can see both on the full proteome level and on the phosphoproteome level that we have very nice reproducibility between individual replica, and that we are able to cover very distinct protein and phosphoprotein populations in the different experiments. And because this is a sequential enrichment strategy, we can even see that by summing the intensities over the individual subcellular fractions, we have a relatively good correlation with the intensity in the whole cell lysates. And when we use a set of marker proteins that are known to subcellular markers that are known to reside in the different subcellular compartments, we can see that we have in our 6 different fractions that in the early fractions, we mainly have cytosol and ribosome proteins. In the intermediate fractions, they are enriched for plasma membrane and mitochondrial proteins. And in the late fractions, we have enrichment for nuclear chromatin and nucleolar proteins. If we then try to basically link the proteome with the phosphoproteome, we can see that kinases are typically residing in the same cytosolic compartments as they are, or in the same subcellular compartments as their substrates. In most cases, you can see that proteins that are kinases that are cytosolic here, either in enriched in fraction 1 or 2, that the majority of their substrates are also enriched in the same fractions, whereas, for example, proteins that are in the membrane fraction, such as the EGF receptor, we can also see that its direct substrates also have a tendency to be enriched in the membrane. But of course, we're not only interested in looking at the static phosphorylation level in cells. We wanted to look at the spatiotemporal phosphorylation dynamics. So what actually happens when we stimulate cells with EGF for different time points? And of course, it's known that the EGF receptor upon activation leads to recruitment of cytoplasmic adapter proteins such as Schick, Cypl, and GRAB2. And Cypl is a ubiquitin ligase that then ubiquitinates the receptor, which is important then for its internalization in a process called endocytosis, in which it's being internalized initially into early endosomes that are marked by this RAB5 and EEA1 protein. And this is later then transferred into the late endosomes that are marked by RAB7, and ultimately the receptor is then degraded after fusion with the lysosomes. So we asked ourselves, would we actually be able to capture these kind of intracellular subcellular location events if we stimulated cells with EGF for different time points? So we basically conducted experiments where we used serum-starved HeLa cells in quadruplicates. We stimulated them with EGF for 2 minutes, 8 minutes, 20 minutes, and 90 minutes. And then we performed our subcellular fractionation scheme and basically read out the proteome and the phosphoproteome with using this DIA strategy with very short gradients. So altogether, we had 5 different stimulation time points. We had 4 different biological replicates. we recorded 6 different subcellular fractions, analyzed 2 different signaling layers, so both the proteome and the phosphoproteome. So altogether 240 samples that just took us 4 days of mass spec analysis time to analyze. And to figure out which proteins actually seems to change location, we then developed a so-called mobility score, where we could compare the different time points against each other for all the individual subcellular compartments. And to our relief, we could see that some of the proteins that were significantly changing from one compartment to another was the known proteins such as Schick, GRAP2 and SIPL, but there was also many other proteins that has not previously been described to move subcellular location as a function of EGF stimulation. But again, looking at the adapter proteins, we can see that they very nicely reproduce the known biology, that at the zero time point before EGF stimulation, all of the adapter molecules are mainly present in the cytosolic compartment. But then as soon as we activate the cells with EGF, we can see already within 2 minutes, they are basically then being recruited to the plasma membrane, so the membrane-bound organelles, and they peak after 8 minutes of stimulation. But then after 20 and 90 minutes, we can see that they are basically being internalized and returned to the cytosolic compartments. But this is not only the case for the proteins. We can see that this actually also coincides very nicely with the phosphorylation sites on the these adapter molecules. So where the EGF receptor itself, we can see that it's mainly in on the plasma membrane that we see tyrosine phosphorylation, autophosphorylation sites on the receptor. We can see that the adapter molecule, such as Schick, is phosphorylated initially mainly in the plasma membrane fraction after being recruited to the receptor, but later on, as the adapter molecule is returned to the cytosol, we can see that it's also phosphorylated there. And interestingly, we can even see downstream transcription factors that are getting phosphorylated both in the cytosol and in the nucleus in response to EGF stimulation. So a couple of years ago, we showed that we can actually perform EGF stimulation in vivo. And we repeated now these results in order to study the subcellular relocation of proteins and phosphorylation sites in liver and kidney cells in mice that had been treated either with EGF or with a saline. And after perfusing with protease and phosphatase inhibitors, 10-minute stimulation, we then snap froze the organs, performed the subcellular fractionation, and analyze the resulting fractions by mass spectrometry. And again, we can see that we have very good reproducibility of all the 4 different fractions. And interestingly, we can see that there were some differences between liver cells and kidney cells. But most strikingly, when we compared the phosphorylation of the EGF receptor in HeLa cells versus in liver cells, we could see that at the basic total protein level, that the receptor in both HeLa cells and liver cell is mainly present in the at the plasma membrane fraction. But in HeLa cells, we can see that the phosphorylation of the receptor also mainly takes place in the at the plasma membrane, whereas for in the liver cells, we can see that after 10 minutes of stimulation, we have kind of a dual distribution. So we have phosphorylated receptor both in the plasma membrane, but also phosphorylated receptor in the cytoplasm. And this, of course, was very interesting to study in some more detail. And for that, we turned our attention again to the early endosomes, since we know that the receptor is quickly internalized after being phosphorylated. And we could see that our early endosomes that are marked by EEA 1 and RAP 5 in HeLa cells seems to mainly be enriched in the membrane-bound organelle fraction, whereas in liver cells and kidney cells, we see a clear enrichment of these cytoplasmic organelles in the fraction 1. Conversely, we could see that the late endosomes that are marked by RAP5 in both liver, HeLa cells and kidney cells seems to be enriched in the membrane fraction. So again, this nicely explains why we see this dual distribution of EGF receptor in both the cytosolic fraction and in the membrane-bound fraction. And in order for people to make use of this resource data set, we actually created a web resource where you can go in and look up your favorite protein and basically see how its profile changes as a function of EGF stimulation, both in HeLa cells or in mouse cells, and also its corresponding phosphorylation sites. But the EGF stimulation was more like a proof of concept, so we actually now wanted to use this to study a more interesting response, so the osmotic shock response. And to perform these experiments, we made use of the U2S cell line that we treated with sorbitol for 1 hour and then performed a washout for 30 minutes, 3 hours, or 24 hours. And again, performing all of the experiments in quadruplicates. And after analyzing both the proteome and the phosphoproteome, we could see that this sorbitol stimulation and release leads to very effective activation of the MAP3K20 MAP kinase, also known as SAC, that is an important stress kinase that is upstream of P38 and JNK. But in order to find proteins that are significantly changing between different conditions, we then performed the gene set enrichment analysis of the different osmotic shock response fractions. And one of the most enriched proteins was the large ribosomal subunit that we could see basically seems to translocate during sorbitol treatment. So from the cytosol, basically fraction 2, to the fraction 6, which is the nucleolar fraction. And of course, it's known that the ribosome consists of two different subunits. So there's both the large subunit and the small subunit. But we could see that during our treatment, so basically with sorbitol and after release, that we seem to have an accumulation of the large ribosomal subunit in fraction 6, whereas we didn't seem to have a major change in the small ribosomal subunit in fraction 6 during the treatments. And of course, it's known that the ribosome biogenesis actually takes place in the nucleolus, and that's exactly our fraction 6 that is highly enriched in nucleolar proteins. And we can see after osmotic shock that we basically have an accumulation of the large ribosomal subunit in the nucleolar and basically a reduction of the ribosomal subunit in the cytoplasm. And in order to validate this finding, we then performed osmotic shock treatment with sorbitol and using fluorescent microscopy, using a specific marker, fibrillarin of the nucleolus. And we can see in untreated cells that we actually have one of the ribosomal large subunits here, RPL10A. There's not really any significant overlap between the nucleolar marker protein and the RPL10. But as soon as we treat the cells with sorbitol for 3 hours, we can see that they have a very strong accumulation in an overlap with the nucleolar markers. And to see why that is the case, we basically performed a northern blot using two different ribosomal RNA probes, and one specific for the 40S subunit and one specific for the 60S subunit. And we could see that it was only in the case of the 60S subunit when treating the cells with sorbitol that we had degradation, very specific degradation of the 60S ribosomal RNA, which likely explains why we see this accumulation of this subunit in the nucleolar fraction. And actually, ribosome biosynthesis stalling by osmotic shock is in many ways similar also to the type of stress that is induced during muscle contraction and stimulation. So again, we performed an in vivo experiment where we basically use mice, where we would then harvest the skeletal muscle after stimulation in one leg and compare it to the corresponding resting muscle in the other leg. Again, we could, after 15 minutes of muscle stimulation, we could then harvest the muscle, snap freeze them, and basically go through our subcellular fractionation protocol. Again, we could see that in this case here, it was not only the 60S ribosomal subunit, but also the 40S ribosomal subunit that seems to significantly change between the cytosolic fractions and the nucleolar fractions between the untreated blue and the muscle activated in red. And if you're interested in this study, you can look at the preprint that we have on bioarchive. So with that, I've basically reached the conclusions. I hope that I've been able to show you that our workflow, subcellular workflow, basically allows for very fast and comprehensive subcellular maps at the proteome and phosphoproteome layers, that we can study EGF stimulation in cells and in mice. And this is a very nice application to study spatiotemporal phosphoproteome dynamics during intracellular signal transduction, where we can see how proteins can move between different subcellular compartments as a function of phosphorylation activation. And by inducing stress signaling in response to hypertonicity, we can see that this results in this transient accumulation of the large ribosomal subunits in the nuclei, and this is likely due to aberrations in the biosynthesis and assembly of the ribosomal machinery. And with that, I've basically reached the acknowledgement. So this was work done in close collaboration with a number of groups at the University of Copenhagen. So both my own group here, but also the group of Alicia Lundby and the group of Simon Becker Jensen. We have very close collaborations with Fridtjof Lund Johansen's group from Oslo University. All the developments that we do on the mass spec instrument side is in close collaboration with Alexander Makarov's team from Thermo Fisher Scientific in Bremen. We closely collaborate with Evoset Biosystems on the LC and chromatography parts and on the magnetic pull-down experiments and the phosphopeptide enrichments. We have a close collaboration with Resin Biosciences, and for the software with the analysis using Spectronaut, we closely work with Biognosys. And then, of course, I also like to thank the funding agencies that provide the resources to conduct this research. And finally, I'd like to thank you for your attention, and I'll be happy to take questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Jesper. That was a really impressive presentation of what one can accomplish when they put all these techniques together. and what you can do. So I just hope if you have a question, I've been answering many as they came along and I asked you a few. So if you have a question, now's a great time to send it in. And while we're waiting, you know, one of the struggles that that I want to ask you about that we have is that when you start to have really big data sets where you have several hundred or more experiments, you get these batch effect things where you can see that. Now, I guess you counter that pretty effectively when you can make your method short like you've done. Is that part of the reason you go there?
Yeah, so I mean, that's actually the reason why we kind of shifted from TMT labeling to single shot DIA type of analysis. So we realized that TMT works extremely well when you can keep all of your conditions within the same TMT set. But as soon as you have to split your samples between several different TMT sets, we often have this problem of batch to batch variations, that we have a lot of missing values in one data set compared to the other data sets. And therefore, we actually found that when you instead do DIA, we have much more, we have less missing values, and especially with the relatively short gradients, although you may not get comprehensive coverage, you usually have sufficient coverage to cover all the most important signaling pathways that you're interested in studying.
So I guess relevant to our earlier conversation this morning about PTMs, PTMs are a bit special because the TMT allows you to get better overlap from one sample to the next. Do you notice that too?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. That's of course an advantage that that you have with TMT labeling, especially when you can put your different samples together in the same TMT datasets, and that also allow you then to do more extensive fractionation, so you can get much better coverage of the, for example, phosphoproteome.
Right, right. Here's a question from Evgenia. She says, do you normalize the amount of protein that is used for a phospho-enrichment from different subcellular fractions since they naturally have varying amounts of protein?
Actually, we initially thought that we should do that, but in the end, we couldn't really do it because we, from each of the replicas, we start with just one P15 dish. And since we do this sequential enrichment, we actually are left with very little material per fraction, and there's not really enough to do an accurate estimation of the protein amounts that we're left with. So we actually just decided to go for enriching all that was in each of the individual subcellular fractions and analyze all of it on the mass spec. And that's also why we can see that when we sum up then their intensities over the different fractions, that it actually correlates very well with the total intensity in the whole cell lysate.